Welcome to the OP Noobs All Members Official Podcast, discussing all good things PC gaming.
Yes, thank you, Dave. Welcome everybody to the OP Noobs Official All Members Podcast, episode number 2. Every Tuesday night, your host, Mikey Mike, aka The Lonely Asian, who's not here with us tonight, as well as our co-host, Danny LeBlanc, Kyle, who's also not here with us tonight, but we've got Dave and Josh to make up for the situation, invite the members in the crew to get on Mumble and discuss some of this week's hottest news on PC gaming. How do you say Mumble? I cannot say
just
Mumble.
Just like you said it, Fred, Mumble.
I think you're saying it pretty well, Mumble.
I think we should hear it the British way, Dave.
Big three.
Teams.
Well,
that about describes it.
We've got a bunch of people on Mumble tonight, actually, and we're pretty happy about it. Thanks, everybody, for tuning in. We think we've got a good show for you guys tonight. Most importantly, we're going to have an interview at 9:30 p.m., which is about half an hour from now, which we're pretty excited about. But before we get there, we're going to get started with a round of hot news about the PC gaming universe. We're going to start right off, guys, with Microsoft Xbox boss, who said it's time to talk about gaming on Windows. Now, this comes from techtimes.com. And I'm just going to read the blurb for you right here tonight so we can get the conversation started. The screenshots from the latest consumer build of Windows 10 show Microsoft is planning to add a new Xbox app for the latest iteration of its desktop operating system. Now, that might sound like a bunch of gibberish to you, but basically it means that a video online shows that Windows 10 carries its own Xbox app, which could be useful for connecting Xbox video gaming systems to your desktop. The app appears to be a gateway for Windows 10 to gain access for the entire user's Xbox activity, including achievements, friends list, activity feeds, and the store. Earlier this month, Xbox chief Phil Spencer said on Twitter that he's working on what Xbox is doing for Windows 10. Now, I think the big question that came up in my head when I started reading this news was, would you plug in an Xbox to your desktop?
Depends because, how good my computer... I interrupted you, sorry about that.
Yeah, that's the first thought that came to my mind. But then I started thinking about it, and I wonder, is this Microsoft and is this the console industry fighting back at Steam, at Valve, who's basically introducing the Steam box to compete against the console world? So, Danny,
I feel like they're just trying to make up.
Go ahead.
What was that? Oh, I was going to say, I feel like they're just trying to make up for lost time.
What do you mean lost time? Like the battle against PS4?
Yeah, when it comes to Xbox and PS4, some people say PS4 is better, some people say Xbox is better, and in this case, I'm a PC gamer. However, if I had to choose, I'd choose PS, because Xbox is just, they're still making people pay for online, they're still making not as good quality games.
I don't know.
Well, you also have to, you were saying something, Fred?
No, please go ahead.
You also have to think about how, you know, Microsoft is a software company, and so they could probably provide a better service like that internet, you know, gaming. I mean, that's where I'm looking at. I don't know all the stats and details and everything, but, you know, just a general overview of it, you know, that's probably where that's coming from, you know, paying to play online. Whereas Sony is a hardware company, so their console is going to be better, but their online play and games might not be as good.
Personally, personally, I feel like I'm very, very distrustful of Microsoft right now because they just dropped Windows Live, which made quite a few of my favorite games pretty much unplayable for several months, and some of them still can't be played. So I'm very, very interested.
I mean, Xbox Live is not the they're not the lonely wolves here. Like, bad ports are becoming notorious in the industry, especially this year.
I mean, what I'd like to know, what advantage am I going to get to my PC or Xbox by linking them together? What's it going to do for me if it's just to use a keyboard and mouse? Just make it compatible for an Xbox? Do you know what I mean? What are you going to gain from plugging that Xbox into a PC?
So what I think the advantage here is going to be that you're going to be able to take your laptop on the road and game from the cloud. So you're basically going to have access to your online library, similar to Steam, but you're going to be able to take your machine anywhere but play your Xbox games, as long as it's obviously a Microsoft Windows 10 machine.
But you don't think it's going to be dependent on the graphics card? Basically,
well,
like...
Yeah, obviously that's going to play a huge part, I'm sure. But I see, like, there are, you know, new cloud-based services that are offering the ability to play high-end, you know, games through the cloud, even if you're not on a high-end computer.
Yeah. Yeah, but what are your thoughts, Danny, on Steam coming to your TV? Do you think that's going to work?
Not necessarily. I don't think that they have a big enough market share, or I don't think they're actually going to gain it, in my personal opinion, because, you know, Microsoft and Sony and Google and all those companies are huge. They just own so much of the market share right now. And Steam coming out with their attempt to make the Steam box and make it accessible, like, all throughout your household and everything like that, that's probably going to work for people who are in the gaming niche that are, like, aware of Steam and everything like that. But I mean, otherwise, they're not, like, a commercially recognizable brand to, like, the general consumer public. So I don't think, I'm not really clear on what the whole motive behind that is personally.
Any other intake on the Steam Box?
Personally, Steam Box, it's an interesting concept that they're trying to imply into it. And if they can get it to work up properly, more to them. And it mainly just depends on how well it'll work out. Because right now it's kind of hard to tell. But it's one of those things where we'll have to wait and see.
I think Steam Valve is going to steal a big share of the console market. I think when you're, especially because you're going to start, is there not keeping it like, you're going to have more than a Steam machine. They're opening it to a bunch of companies to just make their own. And with the ability to build your own rig, which I think up till this stage has been something that really defines PC gaming. The ability to take that onto your TV and sit down on a couch and play with your friends and not buy a console that's going to cost you $500 plus the games, plus all the accessories. You're basically spending the same money, but in 2 years, 3 years down the line, you can update your rig so that it looks better, it feels better, it plays better. That's something, you know, like you look at the PlayStation 3, you look at the Xbox and the Xbox 360, and we've been stuck with those systems for 7 years. It literally, like, it came out when the Bush administration was was full up and running, and you're stuck with that stuff, stuck because there's nothing better for your TV, and stuck because they're not willing, they're that hesitant to shift to a new system, even though the technology is there, because they're going to lose a huge population. That's why they're still building games for PS3 even a year after the game is out. So I think Steam has something that's very attractive for that specific industry, and I honestly believe that this piece of news is basically Xbox saying, getting back at Steam and saying, we're going to try to do the same thing, but the logic here really doesn't apply, because you're the PC gamers are not going to plug their Xbox. Look at us,
Fred. You know? Just to interrupt for a second, sorry. I think there might be an issue with Twitch. I have a couple people saying that the video feed isn't up at all. In fact, I'm trying to load and it says failed to load video. Do you know what's up with that?
It's broadcasting the Twitch feed, talking in it as well.
Yeah, I think it's fine. I usually like to blame Dave, but I don't think I'm allowed to this time. I think it's working fine.
They still might get away with it.
Yeah, it's
working on mine.
It's working fine. I got a couple things to say about the whole Steam.
Please.
Box. I have two perspectives on it. On the one hand, you can play PC game exclusives on your TV, which could be somebody give me a PC exclusive.
World of Warcraft.
Yes,
only
yeah.
PC exclusive.
It is not.
Yeah, seriously.
And I mean,
what
there's
mean,
also
works on Mac.
But let him finish his thought.
GTA 5 first person, which is coming out on Steam. I mean, there's that too. But on the other hand, I would like to see them make it so you can play an RTS as a controller. If they can do that, I would give them all my money.
You can play an RTS exactly. Now on your PC with a controller?
Yeah, but
I
who
don't
does
think
that?
So. If you can, it'd be difficult.
Yeah, you'd have to have a massive controller. You can actually play Dota and things with your Xbox.
Yeah,
you just have to tune the buttons in, right?
You also have to have a converter for... It's a little plug-in to plug into your computer.
For the 360 pad, yeah, obviously you buy the Microsoft Wireless converter and that's
it. I could see you being able to play League or Dota on a controller, but I mean, like, Supreme Commander or Planetary Annihilation or Dawn of War. I can't see
actually,
being
Supreme,
able to...
Actually, Supreme Commander did come out on... Supreme Commander did come out on Xbox and it was awful.
I think as well, yeah. We're going to take in now the next gen consoles. I don't know if because my missus plays one. She plays the new Final Fantasy Online game on her PlayStation 4. And the support now is that you can plug a keyboard in and use that on the PS4. So that support is there. So will MOBAs go to consoles? Yes. The next gen consoles will have MOBAs. And RTSs.
But I mean, even do a lot of people do that? Do a lot of PC gamers actually plug in a Xbox 360 controller and play games on their PCs?
I do, yeah.
I
I'm playing a racing
game, a lot of them do.
If I could, I would. But I mean, I would suck because I'm better at the keyboard, TBH.
When you have people who are like me,
I love this. I love this little thing right there, the Razer Naga. That's...
No, it's all about the Logitech.
Oh, that's beautiful. Oh, dude.
Yeah, that's... For me, this is the only way to play.
When you have people who are like me, and I started out as a console gamer, and now I'm switching over to PC games, it's much more comfortable for me to just plug in an Xbox controller into my PC. Especially since with Street Fighter coming out either next year or the year after that. A lot of people are going to want to be able to plug in their fights to their PCs in order to play it.
Yeah, I mean, Fred, have you ever tried playing a racing game with a keyboard?
Yeah, so I'm not even into racing games.
But
I
if
don't
you
think
are,
racing...
you've got to use an Xbox pad because of the analog controls or the Logitech pad or something like that. You can't literally play a racing game on your keyboard. It's dreadful.
But to me, that's a genre for console gaming.
Yeah.
I disagree.
That's racist.
Yeah, I disagree.
Well, I don't think it's racist. I think that's...
Fred, you had touched on this... Or not Fred, Danny. You had touched on this earlier that Steam isn't really known to the general public. It's mostly, you know, the gamers. And a lot of people who are on these, you know, Xboxes especially... are, you know, your bro gamers, you know, the Call of Duty players and everything. And I think Valve is wanting to get into that market. That's why they made the Steam Box, to get into that bro gamer market who's just, you know, ready to crash in their living room with a bag of Doritos and play with their friends, you know, instead of, you know, setting up their, you know, good rigs, you know, these great PCs and being, you know, probably miles apart, you know.
I mean, gotcha. My view.
I think that's why Valve would get in there.
I honestly think the Steam Box will fail because it's only going to appeal to a really small player market. We all know we can all build our own PCs with PC gamers. We all know how to build micro box units, which will probably cost cheaper. The Steam Box has to be below $400 to break into the console market.
That's true.
And unless they can do that and keep it down, what's the point? You can build a decent PC rig, a micro PC rig for $500 now that you can take downstairs and plug into your TV. The Steam Box isn't really anything new, and they've got to market it very cleverly, otherwise it will definitely fail. There's no advantages of having it.
Yeah.
And again, I bring up the example of the Ouya, which is similar in the sense that, you know, it's open to Android development and people can like get the software dev kit and develop games and then put them up onto that platform very easily. It's very fluid. And I think that's kind of what the approach is with the Steam console, like, it's going to allow indie developers easier access to marketing their games to a bigger, you know, demographic and whatever.
So, Danny, I completely agree with what you just said, but can you tell us your personal experience with the Ouya? Because every single time you bring it up, I think you've wasted money on it, didn't you?
All right, to be completely honest, I have never even seen one in real life. I was following the Kickstarter campaign or whatever they were doing, and it was kind of like had my interest. I never actually pulled the trigger and picked one up, but a couple friends of mine did, and they were highly disappointed in terms of, you know, the games that were available at launch and just like how the console kind of just died like immediately after it was released.
It's already dead. Like people consider it. It's already dead.
Yeah, it's totally obsolete at this point.
God, that's a failure. That's a big failure. I think they were trying to target the iPhone audience, the iPad audience, and saying if you like this type of games, come on TV or something like this. That's okay.
And they want, you know, a lot of the games are supposed to be free and everything like that. It's kind of interesting.
I want to move on to the next piece of news before we get into the call. This is something that I think happened either this morning or yesterday. It's something that shocked me, and I'd like to have your opinion on it. So, Valve rarely prevents a game from being published through Steam. It's got its Steam Greenlight thing. And by the way, this comes from TechSpot. But when the gruesome mass shooter game called Hatred appeared on Steam Greenlight, the company felt it was necessary to intervene. Just hours after the game was launched on Greenlight, allowing gamers to vote for its inclusion in the main store, Valve pulled it. I'm gonna stop right here and just say that if you go on Steam right now and you check out Hatred, I don't even know if you can access it. But basically, it was one of those indie games that immediately was super popular. I think it was top 7 out of a list of thousands. This is the reaction of the game's developers.
So you want it like 22,000, but you think it's complicated?
Yeah, it was high up. People were digging this game. See, this is the game developer, Polish Studio Destructive Creations, a friendly name, described the title as a game about killing people, citing the antagonist's deep-rooted hatred as a motive for slaughtering innocent civilians and police officers in a self-proclaimed, this is hardcore, not PG-13, genocide crusade. That's coming from the developer.
My question to be, here first.
Hold on, let me finish. I just got one paragraph, and then you can go. The game's trailer depicts the antagonist running around the street of a city, entering buildings just to mow down civilians with a range of weapons. The objective appears to be to kill as many people as possible. Go ahead, Dave.
What's the difference between this game and Grand Theft Auto, Mafia, and all those sort of games? What's the difference?
There is none.
The big difference is, in my opinion, and you can beg to differ, is
Cash
that
behind
it's,
the name.
Yeah.
That, yeah. And I guess there's a big difference with motive and stuff. Like when you're playing Grand Theft Auto, your motive behind killing people isn't just to kill people. Your motive usually is these people in the maid, maybe you're robbing a bank or whatnot. Whereas with hatred,
but you're
the
still
motive
killing
just
people.
To kill people.
I mean, you're still
yes.
doing right at it.
Yeah,
I mean,
like
what...
I said, like these people are just happen to be in the way of the bank robbery, whereas supposed of hatred was just killing people just to kill people.
Yeah,
right.
So
you
say
agree.
Walk around in Grand Theft Auto just with a baseball bat, just killing people. That's like a way of relieving it. There's no motive for me doing that. I just walk around killing people.
Has anyone played Oblivion or Skyrim with cheats? Especially Oblivion with the spell Finger of the Mountain.
It's super critical.
A case could be made that it's worse to have no motive to kill people than having a motive. But I agree. The reason that it's been just like completely cut off is that whereas in a game like Grand Theft Auto, your whole point is you can kill people, yeah, you can go out and like slaughter people. It's not really the point of the game. Or the point of this game, and I was reading the article, it literally says the objective appears to be to kill as many people as possible. And that's pretty messed up, I think, because
I completely disagree. I gotta say, I completely disagree. I don't think, until a certain extent, morality is important to the video gaming world. But really, like, the boundaries of that morality are so much tighter than any other entertaining industry. Yeah, of course, like, if you build a game around sheer adoration of Nazism, then I say, yeah, pull the game out of Steam. But to take a little indie out, just because it's pretty much blunt about the fact that people enjoy killing people in video games, I think is messed up. If the game is good, if the game is entertaining, you shouldn't take it out of people's hands. It's a personal opinion. It does not reflect the views of the company. I just want to add. But I'm shocked. I'm personally shocked. And I thought, you know, it goes against the philosophy of Greenlight, of Greenlight's program, which is to say, if you're a small developer and you want to find an open platform to prove yourself, do so. And I believe in free speech in that aspect, as long as you're not, I agree, genocide crusade, that's hardcore. And that, you know, I should probably do a little bit more research before I voice my opinion. So in a way that's so outspoken, but I'm baffled. I can't believe they did it.
I think the numbers speak for themselves, you know. It went from, you know, over a list of 22,000 games on Greenlight to number 7. Within hours, because within hours it was taken down, you know? I mean,
so you're with so, me. You kind of agree with me.
It is entirely stupid that it was taken down. However, I can understand why. Especially with recent news politically. This Sunday, it was Sunday or Saturday, police busted into a cafe because there was a siege there. Someone was being taken hostage. In Pakistan, there was a school shooting, and in Philadelphia, there was another terrorist attack. Not sure what was in Philadelphia.
They don't want to. Oh, what's the word? They don't want to promote that. And like, it is a very, very different like circumstance for most games to get pulled. I remember when War Z got pulled and then put back on because of fraud or something. I remember when there's one game, I cannot remember for the life of me what it was called, but it was so horribly made and it was false advertised that it got pulled off. And then there was another game that got pulled off because the guy that made it threatened to kill Gabe Newell on Twitter. That's a funny story. You should look it up.
Yeah, I remember that one.
But it's different, but I can see. I think I understand why it got pulled because, like I said, it's all about the motive. Like, there's a difference between killing people on the side and then just killing people simply for the sake of killing people.
And it's like a Call of Duty Russian airport scene, like the controversy that causes. Like, you're basically going, your objective is to go in as a, quote, terrorist and mow down innocent civilians.
That was the best part of the game.
You don't even have to do that. And that's I see a meme that comes up every so often on my dash, and it's like, you know we're horrible people because we kill these people without being asked to. You can literally go through that entire level and not shoot a single civilian. I know because I did it.
But don't you think it's hypocritical?
Can't you also skip that level as well?
Yeah, because of just how graphic and controversial that is. That's probably the only reason it was allowed in the game. Just because you could skip it.
Yeah.
We've got to name the goldfish. The streamers demanded that there was a goldfish on the screen. We have a goldfish on the podcast, but we have to name him.
Yeah, you should.
We're going to name him Freddy Jr. His name's Freddy Jr.
Okay, I'll name
Freddy
him.
Jr.
I don't know if I should feel flattered. I don't know if I should feel flattered or ashamed. Oh, nice. We're getting a live stream of the goldfish. You know, my kid eats that, and he's like 2 years old, Josh. And I tried it. It's not that. There's better out there. We can't hear you. Oh, we have a friendly face right here that just stepped in. All right.
That's actually Adam.
That's the Adam guy. Nice to meet you, Adam.
Isn't it a problem if I jump on a Skype call or
let's keep the show going. Danny, why don't you tell us about the Steam winner sale?
Okay, yeah. So basically there was some news that really got, you know, kind of leaked early where somebody in Japan received a early promotional email from PayPal, which like they tend to have like this like lookout program you can sign up for, where it's like it alerts you of upcoming sales or whatever. And it had indicated that the Steam sale, the winter sale, was going to be starting on December 18th, I believe.
Yeah.
So this got posted on Reddit and it blew up all over the internet, obviously. And there hasn't been any, I don't think there's been official confirmation yet, but it is, you know, pretty likely that that's going to be the date, given the fact that the same thing happened during or before the fall sale this year, and people were able to peg the date ahead of time, which is pretty cool.
How does that happen, in your opinion? Like, how does Steam Valve in Japan get a leak of PayPal in Japan gets a leak of what happens in Steam in the US? Like, who's behind this?
I feel a certain Shigeru Miyamoto is behind that.
How does it make me feel too safe?
I'd like to bring up the fact that Steam had just put out recently the new winter background, and it is going crazy over the auction. And it is just, right now, I believe it's for 1,000 gems, it is like $1.30, $1.50. So, and it's just blown up about it.
They had to pull that whole program down, I guess, earlier this week because somebody had found a hack where you can literally generate like billions of gems or something and buy games with that. So they had to like pull it down and fix that.
Yeah.
Yeah. I put something up for, I'm bidding on something on the auction, and I think it's a really great idea. I think they should keep this going year long just because it's awesome.
What are you bidding on?
Audio, sir.
Nice.
I only have 1,000 gems, so I mean, that pretty much limits what I can and can't get.
The question is,
buy gems now.
And I'm not too sure how I got my sourcing from, but I got the news from christiantoday.com.
Yeah, I got that too. That was the first site that came up for source.
Like for right or for wrong, but this is what christiantoday.com says. Who knew they were waiting for the Steam sale? They say the seasonal sale is known as a great venue to buy different game titles at more affordable prices, something we as PC gamers already know. We actually wait for it. In my opinion, there's the Thanksgiving sale, which is awesome, and then the Christmas sale, which is where I spend all of my big bucks. But okay, so this is what's up about this year. And I get all excited and I'm about to read the news. What's coming out? There's a leak. It comes from Japan. I don't know why, but what's up? And they say this. Some of the expected titles that will be featured in this year's Steam Winter Sale include Counter-Strike Global Offensive and Trials Fusion. And I'm thinking WTF. Are you serious? Like, you're not gonna give me some Far Cry 4 for $7, some Call of
Duty
are you seriously gonna sell me, is seriously Santa Claus gonna sell me Counter-Strike Go for like $10 and I'm supposed to feel lucky about that? And then Trials Fusion, who the F plays Trials Fusion?
But again, sales are the surprise, and they're like, oh, what's going to come up next? And you get to vote and all that stuff. So they're not. I have a feeling they're not going to announce all the big players that they're going to surprise us with.
I like the fact
that... So wait, hold on, just a quick second. You don't think it's Christian Today that's excited about Trials Fusion?
Well, maybe that's the only game they're exposed to or something. I don't know.
See, I'd like to touch on the fact that a Christian thing and somewhere in Japan, they know more about this than us Americans.
Yeah, sure.
There's another source that said that it's going to be starting on the 18th. I can't remember what it was, but I saw it on Facebook a couple days ago. I think it might have been Kotaku.
Fred, I don't want to jump in, but it's 5:30, by the way.
Oh, yeah. Give me a second. Let me check. Yep, he's ready. So, guys, without any further delay, we're going to introduce the musician, the composer behind the music of Diablo 3, StarCraft 2, the Burning Crusade expansion, World of Warcraft, Warlords of Draenor, and the next upcoming game from Blizzard. And if anybody can remind me the name right here, it'd be appreciated. Overwatch.
Yeah.
Close enough. Yeah, Overwatch. So we're going to bring in Neil Acri. We're going to ask everybody to get on Twitch if you're not already, because you won't be able to hear this on Mumble. This is going to be a slight delay, but we're going to bring in Neil Acri on Steam. And Danny, are you ready to take over?
I am.
Wait, bring him in on Steam or Skype?
So, Skype.